Hi, I'm Tammy Algood. Everything changes as we age, and our approach to food is no exception. Cooking for one, adapting to any functional limitations, or accessing healthy food can be a challenge for both older adults and caregivers trying to meet their loved ones' nutritional needs. The following program is meant to provide practical nutrition and safety tips for older adults cooking at home. While these are general tips, everyone is different. If you have any health concerns, food allergies, or are taking medications that might interfere with foods we discuss in the program, talk to your healthcare provider first. Thanks for joining us.
Major funding for NPT Reports, Aging Matters, is provided by the West End Home Foundation, improving the quality of life of seniors through the support of nonprofit organizations in Middle Tennessee. The HCA Foundation, on behalf of TriStar Health. The Jeanette Travis Foundation, dedicated to improving the health and well-being of the Middle Tennessee community. And Cigna HealthSpring. Additional support provided by Lyle Parham Wealth Management of UBS Financial Services Incorporated, Jackson National Life Insurance Company, the Community Foundation of Middle Tennessee, and by members of NPT. Thank you.
Sometimes dealing and finding good, healthy, nutritional foods can be a challenge. So we're going to take a trip for the next 30 minutes through the community and the kitchen, and we're going to start at the grocery store. I'm here with my friend Meg Maeser, and she is a nutritionist that's going to take us through the grocery store. So Meg,
let's go.
And we're going to start here with some nuts, a good protein source. So talk to us about this, Meg, and how this can be a good value for anybody, really.
Absolutely, and it can be very overwhelming because there's trail mix, there's peanuts, there's different types of options. So the biggest thing we want to look at with some of these items is the sugar content. So some of these items have fairly high sugar, 12 grams of sugar here, low on the fiber. So ideally, we want to go for a one nut option. Now, I know for myself, when I pick something, one serving turns into I eat half of a bottle. So these items are great because you can get almonds and walnuts mixed in one, or just almonds, and they're little 100 calorie packs, but you can see the sugar difference and the calorie difference, and it keeps you in portion for your healthy fats for the day.
So the only thing to really think about as far as that's concerned is it's a little more expensive than buying the bulk.
Yes.
So nuts.
So an option two would be when you get your container, see how many servings are in it. You can measure them out in individual baggies, and that just helps keep you in control of how much you're consuming.
Got it. So chewing can sometimes be an issue. Mm-hmm. So what's a good alternative if actual whole nuts provide a little bit of a chewing issue?
Absolutely. My favorite is some of the nut butters.
Show us what we need to look for.
Okay, so we think that everything's created equal, and it's not. So let's, for example, I'm gonna grab this crunchy peanut butter. I love it, it's peanut butter. What can be so different than these other options? But what you wanna look out for is the sugar content, but also what's sneaky is the sodium. It's loaded with sodium here in comparison to the other ones I'm going to show you.
Okay.
So some of our options here is we have a natural creamy peanut butter. Sometimes you need to look, and on the front it'll say low sodium. So here's the difference. 75 milligrams versus the 140
wow.
in the regular peanut butter, okay? And lower in the sugar content as well. So even though they're both peanut butters, the natural or organic options are gonna be your better bet because it has better quality ingredients in it.
Okay, so Meg, typically we tell people to shy away from things that are already processed or cut a lot, but this is actually a good option that you think is for our people because it's already washed and cut.
Absolutely. A lot of times chopping, and even like if we cut too thick, it's difficult to chew. So So the more fine we can chop these things, it's easier to chew and easier to digest, especially with our active older adults. So some of these pre-made options, you have the salads already cut up in a bag. I love options like this because it's, see how super finely cut it is?
Right.
And these are already, they come with the dressing, and they already have those sliced almonds like we touched on the nuts. So it has some good additives to give you a very hearty salad.
Well, and sometimes, Meg, I think that a lot of people have trouble visually seeing how much they need to wash their produce. So this is already taken care of in these bags, and it's just, it's basically a meal in a bag.
Absolutely. It's pre-washed and ready to go.
So obviously, Meg, we want to promote shopping for produce in season, but even that sometimes has its challenges. Like, for instance, fresh strawberries. Sometimes that, again, has a little bit of a washing and chewing issue. So you've got a good solution here.
Yes. So I love fresh produce. I do. But unfortunately, sometimes we don't eat it quick enough. And then the next thing, oh, I want some strawberries, and half of them have spoiled. There's money down the drain, and then you didn't get to eat your strawberries. So a good option is frozen. With our frozen options, they're typically frozen at their peak prime. So you get good quality in season strawberries, but being frozen, they're gonna last longer. You can pull them out and thaw what you need. And then as they thaw, they're easier on the palate. So they're softer, so they're easier to chew and easier to digest.
So versus looking at strawberries that are just in season, we can have seasonal produce all year long by utilizing our freezer very wisely.
Yes.
Okay, so Meg, everybody eats cereal, but that's also one of those hidden things where you can get a lot of sugar real quickly. So give us some good suggestions for cereal.
Okay, so a lot of your front part of your label can be very deceiving by saying natural or, you know, high in fiber, when sometimes some of them are not so high in fiber and they're loaded with sugar. So the main thing you want to go with is, when in doubt, at least 5 grams of fiber and single digits in your sugar, so less than 10 grams of sugar. So instead of your typical, you just grab your raisin bran, which has added sugar. They add sugar to the raisins. Get your old-fashioned, you know, bran flakes, add your raisins, add your fruit, you know, add whatever you prefer, and it keeps the sugar down. It has 5 grams of sugar, and it has your 5 grams of fiber already in it.
So Meg, obviously this can be very overwhelming for people as they go through the grocery store. What are some good resources that people where they can learn more about exactly how to grocery shop and to do it really well?
Well, my experience at one of our 50 forward centers throughout Middle Tennessee, our staff and volunteers can help you learn like what to look for in your food and healthy eating. They can help you with food budgets. And then if the need is there, staff or volunteers can assist you and take you grocery shopping.
Meg, this has been really informative. Thanks for joining us here today.
Thank you for having me.
So we've already made it to the grocery store. Now we want to see how we can access that good, nutritious food here at the farmers market. So we are here at the Rutherford County Farmers Market, and I'm Keith Barnes with the Tennessee Justice Center. And Keith, tell me what you do.
Hi, yeah. My role is the Director of Nutrition Advocacy. So, you know, the Tennessee Justice Center, we work to make sure that people have access to the health care and nutrition they need. So I primarily work in helping make sure people are able to access programs like SNAP and school meals and Meals on Wheels.
Got it.
And previously I was with the Commission on Aging and Disability, where I actually basically ran Meals on Wheels for the state. So I've got a lot of experience in older adult food security. And I think a thing a lot of folks don't realize is that 1 in 10 older Tennesseans is actually food insecure. And
wow.
If you look at lower income older Tennesseans, so folks with household incomes below $35,000 a year, that's actually 1 in 5. So it's a really big issue.
And obviously we want those individuals to be able to access good fresh food.
Exactly.
Like this. So tell us about some programs that they can utilize to boost their nutritional intakes with lovely food such as this.
Absolutely. You know, there is kind of a whole tapestry of programs. I mentioned that I used to run Meals on Wheels and actually kind of senior congregate meals, but the best program that we have for older adults, for any person who, you know, just needs a little help putting food on the table is the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. We usually just call it SNAP. I mean, that far and away is the most important program that we have.
And this program allows them to purchase fruits and vegetables and fresh meats, anything that's consumable like this.
Correct. Yes.
To aid with their nutrition. So meats qualify, fruits and vegetables qualify, anything that is that they can take home and utilize. So even here at the farmers market, they could buy tomato plants and herb plants that they grow. Those are eligible things. What are non-eligible?
Yeah, ornamental plants, prepared, pre-made foods. Like, you can't go to restaurant and use your SNAP benefits,
right.
But anything that you can eat at home or grow at home is eligible for SNAP.
And so here at the Rutherford County Farmers Market, they have a unique program that they also have classes that teach you, like, for instance, maybe you don't know how to utilize this particular type of eggplant. Or this chayote. So they've got programs that show you how to utilize these fresh fruits and vegetables, because we want you to take them home and use them correctly.
Mm-hmm.
So tell us a little bit about how they can supplement even their SNAP benefits here at the market.
Absolutely, yeah. So currently, in partnership with the AARP Foundation, there's farmers markets across the state that are actually able to basically double SNAP benefits up to $20. So let's say you're an older person, you get $30 a month in SNAP benefits. Well, you can bring 20 of that to the market and you can get it doubled. And that doubling allows you to purchase extra fresh produce, fruits and vegetables. So it's a really great program.
So it's really cool. It's like a token like this. So this is your SNAP token, and then your supplemental, the fresh savings token, is dollar for dollar match for that. So with these fresh tokens, you can only purchase fruits and vegetables with this, but with your SNAP benefits, you can purchase those plants that we referenced, meats that we've referenced. So this really does serve as a wonderful way to stretch your nutrition dollar for those that are eligible for the program.
Exactly.
And tell us a little bit about who is eligible for this program.
Talking about older adults, there's a lot of misconceptions about the SNAP program. And one of those is, you know, just whether or not somebody is eligible, folks don't realize that they can deduct their medical expenses. So if you're an older adult and you have, you know, you're just have a lot of healthcare needs and you're spending a lot of money on that, you can count those expenses when you apply for SNAP, so it actually brings your income down.
I see.
Yeah, so that's a really important thing that a lot of folks don't realize that can really, you know, help out, make them eligible, help them be eligible for more assistance.
And how do they sign up for SNAP?
So, I mean, the most direct way is to just contact your county Department of Human Services. But I would recommend just calling 211 first, so that you just dial 211 and they're there to help screen folks to see if they might be eligible. So it's kind of that extra touch to guide somebody through the process, because if you haven't done it before, it can seem daunting. You know, I think it's also really important to highlight that food access isn't a personal issue. It really is a policy issue, especially when you're talking about older adults. For every dollar that we've increased Social Security in the last decade, the cost of food has gone up $1.80. Social Security just is not keeping up with the cost of living. And making that even more challenging for many older adults is when you become a widow or a widower, you go from two Social Security checks down to one. So that's where SNAP is really important.
And obviously, this is something that these adults have contributed to their whole lives. So we want them to utilize programs that are there for their benefit that they have contributed to. Okay, so Keith, obviously what we want to do is get the most nutritional food in the homes of people who deserve it. The farmers market is an excellent way to do that. I appreciate the work that you've been doing to help us with that. And the farmers market is a wonderful place to visit and to utilize benefits and double those dollars. So many thanks to you, Keith, and awesome. The programs that you do to make sure nutritional food is available.
Yeah, thank you, Tammy.
Thinking about some good, practical, nutritional, and kitchen tips that we can utilize. And I've got my friend Meg Maeser here, who's our nutritionist. And Meg, we've got a couple of good examples here that are things to be considered when you're in the kitchen. And let's start with fire safety, because that's such a big thing. We always recommend to have these fire extinguishers, but when you look at this, Meg, aren't you just kind of like me? You're in the middle of an emergency and you're trying to figure out how to work this crazy
Absolutely.
Fire extinguisher. So a good alternative to a fire extinguisher that might be a little difficult to utilize is baking soda. And this is a good flame retardant. I prefer having an open container versus a closed container, again, for ease of access. So baking soda is an excellent flame retardant. And then Meg, you talk to me about gripping, because you deal with a lot of senior citizens that have items on high shelves. So talk to me about this particular instrument.
Okay, so for something like this, you may have some areas within your kitchen that's hard to reach, deep within, so trying to sit on your tippy toes, you might lose balance and fall. So having a tool like this will give you the option to be able to grab those hard to reach items. You can lock it if you have one of these grippers that have a lock, and be able to bring that item to you without losing your balance or, you know, increasing your risk of falling.
Which could also eliminate having to use a stepping stool.
Yes, ma'am.
It's because we don't like stepping stools. Again, that's something that causes a balance mm-hmm. problem, wouldn't you say? And in designing your kitchen, I love to think about D-shaped handles instead of knobs. And so we were talking earlier, Meg, about gripping, how the problem with gripping is that you're having to twist and turn a knob, whereas you've got a lever on your sink, or if you've got D-shaped handles on your cabinets, that, and even your doorways, that's even a lot better. Now let's talk about plastic. Talk to me, what do you think about this, Meg? Tell me your perspective.
This is a great option, because a lot of the items that we have, it's either, you know, glass, ceramic. So again, as we get older, sometimes our grip decreases. So we have issues with grip or issues with even balance with our upper extremities. So having glass, you're at higher risk. If you do drop it, what's it going to do? It's going to shatter.
Right.
So if you use plastic, you're, you know, decrease your risk of having those items shatter, because it's really hard to see if you do shatter a glass, those little pieces of glass on the floor. So you increase your risk of, you know, cutting yourself.
Right. Now let's go back to another safety thing, cleaning. Don't you mm-hmm. love to clean?
Absolutely.
So a lot of times our eyesight, we don't see little splits and splatters on your stove or even on your floor that you could slip on. So it's really important for caregivers or elderly to make sure mm-hmm. they have things clean. And then Meg, don't you love this? Talk to me about this.
So a lot of times when we're busy, we're cooking, we're cleaning, we might accidentally take our kitchen towel and leave it on the stove. So when we do that, we're at risk of creating a fire. A lot of our stovetops nowadays, some of our flat tops, you don't know if it's on or off. Sometimes you have to feel the heat. So when in doubt, try to keep all your paper items, all your towels, as far away from the stovetop as possible.
Exactly. If it's not in your hand, it shouldn't be near the grate, right?
Just put it back in the drawer.
Exactly. Then a couple of other tips, light, even at night. Mm-hmm. So make sure you have night lights, plenty of light in the kitchen, and then switch to placemats versus tablecloths so that you don't have the potential of catching the tablecloth in your clothing or that kind of thing and pulling things off of the countertop. Plus, these are easier to clean. Mm-hmm. So these are good practical things for any age, but particularly for our elderly. Mm-hmm. So now we're going to take this a bit further and talk about cookware. Honestly, there are so many people that make the mistake of taking their cookware and placing it on the stovetop and the handle is above another eye. So what we want to really get people in the habit of doing is placing their cookware on the stove correctly, which would be angled towards your controls or even turned out like this so that you can easily pick it up. So the beauty of this is that you can use this with any, do this with any cookware. So if you've got handles that tend to get hot, you can buy these flame retardant things that go on the handle. But the ones that I really like are the ones that just stay on the pot or pan. This way you don't have to worry about it or forget about it. It's just easy to do that.
Now, if you don't have an option to get one of the covers for your plates or your the silicone option, some of our pot holders, I know for me, they get hot spots. They're old-fashioned cotton ones.
Yeah.
And the last thing you want to do is put on one of your pot holders, grab a pan, catch a hot spot, and drop it on the floor. So these options have the silicone directly on the inside to protect your hand. You also have the silicone trivets to protect the pot on your countertop. But what's great are these options. And I know this is one of your favorites.
It works so perfectly. And you can find these at any inexpensive store. They're everywhere. But it just gives you good flexibility, but it also gives you good protection from your hands. And, you know, Meg, honestly, you really need this for certain types of cookware. And you've got one right here that you're going to show us. This right here is a heat conductor.
Mm-hmm. And it is one of our traditional options. The only downside for using our cast iron is super heavy.
Yeah.
So we have some great alternatives versus some of our heavier cookware. And that is one of our slow cooker options that come in multiple sizes.
Yes. I like slow cookers that have a timer on them so that you don't forget and leave it on, even though your fire risk for a slow cooker is so small. Mm-hmm. The beauty of that is that you eliminate having to remember that. If you don't have one with the timer on it, you can use a traditional timer, which we suggest anyway, right, Meg? Because you don't want to leave things on the stove and forget about them. So one of the things that you might remember is that to just start kind of scaling down your cookware. So something really, really big like this, you might want to scale down to something smaller. If you've got something big, two handles are better than one if you've got something big like that. So these are really good practical things that anybody could do, but obviously it's something that's very important in the kitchen for safety reasons. Food preparation can be a challenge. Don't you agree, Meg? I mean, sometimes you're just overwhelmed with the steps that it takes to get through a meal. So obviously there are alternatives that can help you in this area. There is absolutely nothing wrong with purchasing pre-cut vegetables, pre-shredded cheeses, because again, this can be a big hurdle to grate cheese, to cut things. So look in your grocery store, as we've done before, and look for things that are on sale, because obviously the more it's cut, the more it costs. So you really want to think about that. A whole is always going to be best. Now let's talk about flavor, Meg, because you've got some good examples here of flavor options.
Absolutely. And ideally we want to go with whole food nutrition, so fresh fruits and vegetables. But sometimes that's a little bland. So we can doll things up with our food by using fresh or even some of our dried herb options. So I like to use grapefruit, it's one of my favorite, some of the citrus, lime is phenomenal on some of your fish. But even just getting some dried rosemary, use this a little bit on your food. This is gonna give it the seasoning that it needs versus always going toward the salt.
Right, because it's easy to pick up the salt shaker versus to think about even fresh herbs. So you're right. Dried is, I think, even a better alternative. Don't you think so sometimes?
Absolutely. And it's going to last longer. So the last thing you want to do is purchase a lot of our fresh herbs and then they go bad. So, you know, an option is you can buy the fresh, dry them yourself. That's very time consuming. Or just at the store, you can get a variety of different mixes, and they have them labeled: vegetable seasoning, chicken seasoning, low sodium.
Right.
These are options you want to go for, because sodium is hidden in our food, which is going, I'm going to touch on next. Remember at the grocery store, we saw a lot of labels that were questionable. Just because an item says light or healthy or natural does not mean it is good for you. So a lot of your options that say reduced sugar or light dressing have hidden sodium or hidden sugars. So ideally what I try to teach my older adults is read the labels. This is going to help you learn what is in your food. So if you can't pronounce it, don't eat it.
And Meg, when you say read the label, that's not the front label. That's the back label, right? Because we this is where we're getting fooled on the front label, right? The real proof is in the pudding on the back.
Absolutely.
And Meg, one of the things that you were talking about, how you like to use citrus, I also like to use vinegars to flavor food, because again, that's a low salt alternative to it. And then one of the things that I've done is ditch the grinders. As wonderful as they are, even these commercial grinders that you can find, it's sometimes difficult for a senior citizen. Again, it goes back to the knob thing, to twist this and grind. So really what you need to do is just go with the old fashioned shakers. Mm-hmm. Don't you think that's just a better alternative?
It's a great
in the kitchen.
Idea.
We mentioned the slow cooker, and let's not forget about that, because in addition to being able to utilize all of these wonderful fresh fruits and vegetables in a slow cooker, it softens food. So it makes it really easy to be able to consume that food in a softer form. So you can utilize all of that there. You can cook just about anything in the slow cooker, from breads to soups and stews to main dishes, and it eliminates a flame. So again, a slow cooker is probably your best friend when it comes to practically using all of these ingredients that we've just talked about. So I hope that with Meg's help today, you have really understood some small things that you can do to make utilization of your kitchen, your appliances, and your grocery store visits perfect for you and your loved ones. So Meg, thank you for coming and sharing your knowledge with us. We hope that you can practically put these things to work immediately and that you will find success in doing so.
Major funding for NPT Reports, Aging Matters, is provided by the West End Home Foundation, improving the quality of life of seniors through the support of nonprofit organizations in Middle Tennessee. The HCA Foundation, on behalf of TriStar Health. The Jeanette Travis Foundation, dedicated to improving the health and well-being of the Middle Tennessee community. And Cigna HealthSpring. Additional support provided by Lyle Parham Wealth Management of UBS Financial Services Incorporated, Jackson National Life Insurance Company, the Community Foundation of Middle Tennessee, and by members of NPT. Thank you.